When it comes to war, innovation is key. From navigational advancements from the Hundred Years' War, to tanks taking to the battlefields of World War I, to the German V2s of World War II, war forces those in it to innovate, and if they fail to innovate, they may just fail to keep on existing. So it should be no surprise that the greatest war in history saw some of the most radical innovations, and one of those innovations led the Russians to develop the first ever flying tank. If you love watching our videos and learning new things, be sure to check out our Discord, link in the description below. And let's jump in. Imagine it. You're commanding the Russian forces in the midst of World War II. You have enemies on both ends of your nation, a vast empire stretching nearly 6,000 miles or 10,000 kilometers. Roads of the day were certainly not ideal, and depending on the point in the war and how damaged the infrastructure was, it could take days to move forces from Moscow to the front lines, and those were days the Russians didn't have. So some brave engineers came up with an idea. You could already fly troops and have them parachute into combat zones, so why couldn't you do the same with tanks? Ignoring the fact that a state-of-the-art T-26 Russian tank weighed 11 tons, or 10,000 kilograms, the weight of 6 modern-day Subarus. And I'm not just talking about flying them to some nearby military base and having them drive into combat. I'm talking about landing them right in the thick of the battlefield. Well, meet the Antonov A-40. Known in Russian literally as the winged tank, the Antonov A-40 was the brainchild of Oleg Antonov, a Soviet aircraft designer known at the time for his A-7 military glider and later works such as the SKH-1 and a series of aircraft named after him, like the AN-12 quad turboprop, AN-28 reconnaissance plane, and the AN-124 strategic transporter. Before the A-40 came into existence, the Russians had experimented with strapping lighter T-27 and T-37 tanks to the underside of bombers to be flown into combat as early as 1935. But these earlier designs were scrapped because the tanks were simply too small, with too little armor, to be of any use against the Panzer 2s and 3s being deployed by the Germans. Desperate to try anything, the Russians even tried simply dropping tanks out of transport planes, both with and without parachutes, just to see if it was feasible, with the idea being the tank crews would parachute down separately, and then scramble to get into the tanks before enemy troops could take them out. After further testing, Antonov sketched a design for a set of glider wings that could be outfitted on a much larger tank, enabling it to glide while literally being towed in the air behind another aircraft. The flying tank, in theory, would take off behind the wings of a heavy bomber from a normal runway before gliding into the battle zone. In my background research, a lot of people like to call this a genius idea. The idea of gliding a 10-ton tank swiftly through the air, attached to another plane by some cables. But I'm gonna call it something else. Bat crazy. The sketch remained just an idea for another 2 years, but after the Germans began their invasion of Russia, Antonov was commissioned to bring his design to life. Unsurprisingly, the results weren't all that great. Antonov attached a pair of custom-built wings to a modified T-60 tank that would be ejected after landing on the battlefield. Cables running from the wings to the tank's turret would allow the plane to roughly control its movements. While the plane worked in theory, the actual logistics would be its undoing. For starters, due to how little lift the glider wings could provide, armaments, fuel, and even some armor had to be removed from the T-60 tank for its test flight. Even with this lightened load, the Tupolev TB-3 towing the tank, despite having a carrying capacity nearly 3 times the weight of the tank, had its engines overheat on the runway. Although the A-40 did manage to take off and land quote-unquote very smoothly, the plane's maiden test flight would be its last. With the TB-3 struggling to pull even the lightened tank, not to mention the fact that the majority of Russia's TB-3 planes had already been destroyed in the war, and the A-40's wings barely being able to generate the necessary lift, all testing was halted, and the Russians' dream of a flying tank came to an end. As you may have noticed, this was our third video looking at some unusual science or engineering practices from past wars. While these videos are a bit different from our normal content, I really like exploring some of the crazy ideas people came up with in the past, and try to at least look at them from a scientific or engineering perspective. If you like these videos, be sure to let us know in the comment section below, so we don't stop making them. And if you want to check out our other two videos, click here. As always, have a great day, and remember, there is always more to learn.